Whispers from Below, a horror podcast by Justin W. Geis. Scary stories, both real and fake. Hello, listeners. Welcome to Season 4, Episode 5 of Whispers from Below, a podcast by a madman for madmen. I'm your resident psychopath, Justin W. Geis. And today's topic of discussion is 10 facts about Nightmare Before Christmas, one of my all-time, forever favorite movies. I have a tattoo of it. It's just like, that's not a fact. That's more of just like a statement. It's just like a fantastic film. If you haven't seen it, what are you doing with your entire life? Where was your childhood? Go see it. It's amazing. It's fantastic. Before I get into the episode, this is a really okay episode. This is like a kid's movie, so like it's really fine for any listener or viewer to listen to. I do curse, so like if that's something that bothers you, like I'm fucking sorry about that. But besides that, this is like totally fine for younger listeners to get into. Secondly, I just want to address that last week I didn't upload an episode. I got my second dose of the vaccine. I didn't like post anything about it because like, I don't know. I don't really feel a need to like post about it, but I do feel a need to tell you guys because it happened right before I normally record, and then I was in such a terrible state that I wasn't able to record, and then I didn't have time to pass that point. So I wasn't able to record an episode last week, and then I forgot to post that I didn't have time to record. So I apologize for that weird like blip in the system for like a week where I just like didn't record or post anything. I apologize for that. I'll try to be better about updating people. I just like totally blanked. Work has been crazy. My life has been a little like up in the air. So just like a lot going on. But I'm back now and we're here and let's get into the episode. So I'm going to talk about 10 interesting facts about Nightmare Before Christmas. As I said before, it's one of my favorite films ever. I actually have on my right ankle a little tattoo of zero on my ankle, and I plan on making that ankle my Tim Burton ankle. It's going to have a bunch of different characters from some of his films on it, but I adore this film. If I'm ever like upset or anxious or sad, this is one of my like comfort movies that I will just turn on and be excited to watch yet again. It's always nice for me to see it again. Like I'm never like, oh, I gotta watch this movie. I'm always like, yeah, pumped. Like there are sections of it that I'm like, ah, this isn't my favorite and I can't wait for this part to be over. But then look, it's one of my favorite sections, like yet again. And especially like trivia of it, I'm that person as we watch the movie where you miss half of it. Because I'm explaining scenes to you. I'm explaining how they did things. I'm talking about things. Yeah, I'm that type of person when we watch movies. I do it a lot with Beetlejuice, and I need to be better about it because I introduce a lot of people to Beetlejuice. I don't introduce as many people to Nightmare Before Christmas. I feel like this is something that most people have seen by the time that they're my age. They've at least heard about it or seen it once or twice. So then when we rewatch it, it's more just me making them fall in love with it the same way that I am. But like Beetlejuice is one that I feel like missed a whole group of people that I have to sort of like show it to, and I need to be better about just like shutting the fuck up and like letting people watch the movie. But a couple like background info stuff on it. It was released in 1993, and it was considered to be one of the most popular Halloween and Christmas movies of all time. So obviously it's like the only Halloween Christmas movie that like is in existence. But like it is one of the most popular Halloween movies of all time, and it is one of the most popular Christmas movies of all time. It is like a double whammy there, which I just think is like so fantastic. It has this cult following. I'm part of it. And Tim Burton created the film, if you didn't know. But this kind of brings us like quick segue into fact number one, which is why it's fact number one. Is that Tim Burton actually did not direct the film. So the film is directed by Henry Selick. He directed this Disney film. He went on to direct Coraline, which is another one of my favorite movies. It has a very Tim Burton vibe, very dark, It's another stop motion film. Very creepy. The imagery in it is kind of spooky, but sort of like geared towards a younger audience who's into horror. It's like a good like branching thing into like spooky, creepy stuff. If you're a kid that's into that, but you're not really ready yet for like a horror movie, which is why it's another one of my comfort films. I really like Coraline. If you'd like to hear an episode on some interesting facts about Coraline, let me know. I love doing these episodes because if it's stuff that I already know, it's just me talking passionately about stuff that I already know, which I know a lot of you guys have commented on that you really like. And if it's a movie that I don't know as much about, it means I get to do research and learn about more stuff that I can then talk to people about. So either way, it's like a win-win in my book. So just let me know. I love these episodes. And the Beetlejuice one did pretty well. Like, you guys seem to like it. So if you like these, also let me know. But anyway, this was like Henry Selick's like big first sort of thing that he was directing. And at the time, Tim Burton just didn't want to make it stop motion. He just like didn't want to do a stop motion movie. He thought it was like too much work. So it's Tim Burton's Nightmare Before Christmas, but it's directed by Henry Selick. So just like a fun little tidbit. Number two, the film was actually just based on a poem that Burton had written. He pitched the poem to Disney in 1983, but they never ended up biting it. They just like weren't into the idea of it being a film. And then the poem was that he rewrote 'Twas the Night Before Christmas, and he drew designs for Jack, Zero, and Santa Claus. The original poem like only featured Jack, Zero, and Santa Claus. It like didn't have any other characters in it. It was loosely based on 'Twas the Night Before Christmas. It was a poem that he'd rewritten, and he like pitched it to Disney twice. And on the second time, they kind of were like, maybe we could use this idea and like bite it. And it was back when he was, I believe, an animator or a director or something like that for Disney when he pitched it originally. And they were like, no, keep doing your job. And then he kind of like branched out a little bit and kind of found his footing. But yeah, so the film was just based on like a poem that he had written, which is kind of cool. Fact number three, I found this really fascinating, and I actually didn't know this before doing research for the film, but the songs were actually written before the film script was. So every single song in the film, that's what came first. And then the script came. So the score kind of influenced the film itself. Danny Elfman composed the music, for those of you that don't know. Danny Elfman and Tim Burton are kind of like besties at this point. They work together all the time on every film that Tim Burton has like ever done. Danny Elfman is always the composer. Like Edward Scissorhands, Nightmare Before Christmas, all of his like classics, Danny Elfman has composed. Unless he's sort of been doing like when he did Sweeney Todd, right? That was Tim Burton's Sweeney Todd. Yeah. Am I crazy? Yeah. That was his Sweeney Todd. That's like already written. But you know what I mean? Like anything that's like new work, it's pretty much done by Danny Elfman. And Danny Elfman talks about how Burton would sort of describe the plot, the characters, and what would be happening in the film to Elfman. He would be giving him a description of like, so this is what's happening in this scene, and this character is over here doing this, whatever. And then Elfman just wrote the songs and was like, yeah, 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 I got it, Tim. And then the next day a couple days later, he would have a song. And so they sort of worked through the whole film that way. And then they went back and wrote a script for it afterwards. Which just like, that is such a bonkers way to write a movie, but it worked out so well in this case because you can feel that the songs really tie the plot together. Like some of the most important plot telling points are done through song, which I think sort of gets missed a lot in films that have songs in them. I feel like a lot of times the storytelling in a song is definitely like missed, but like, what's this? You know, even Jack's lament, stuff like that. Like, it truly is like a full story, a full monologue that's being told through song. And I just think that that's like so cool and important to see. And the stop motion in the film is like absolutely stunning. So you should definitely go check it out if you're just like a fan of that, especially for the time. So this brings us to point number four. So this is fact number four. Danny Elfman is actually the voice of Jack Skellington in the film, just his singing voice. But the story goes, from what I understand and what I could find, that he did dummy vocals for Jack Skellington and is actually like a trained singer. And he like did the dummy vocals for it, and Burton and Selleck were like, "Hey, you sound really good. Like, do you just want to do it?" And then Elfman like listened back to it and was like, "You know what? I kind of love this. And I would love to be a part of it more because I wrote it." So he is also the voice of Beryl, and the clown with the tearaway face. So when you hear those, that's the same voice as Jack Skellington's singing voice. So he's the singing voice of Beryl, the clown with the tearaway face, and Jack Skellington in the film, which I just think is kind of like yet another fun tidbit that like he did dummy vocals and they were like, "Yo, you're kind of good at this. Do you want to just like do it?" And like, I love Jack's lament. It's in my like audition book, although I never use it for anything because the song is so long and the cuts from it are too long. But I love that song. Like, I've always wanted to perform it. I love it. I love it, love it, love it, love it, love it. And I've heard it so many times. And so just to know that that was the composer kind of makes that song a little bit more special to me, because all those acting choices and all those beats, like, that's what he wanted. You know what I mean? And he got to just do it. Like, I think that's so cool. I think that's so cool. It just makes it that much more special of a performance, you know? Point number five is that it took a group of around 100 people 3 years to complete the film. So I know that that sounds crazy, because it is crazy. But also, you need to consider that every second in the film is 12 stop motion moves. So every single second of that movie is 12 stop motion moves. And that movie is pretty smooth, but for a lot of like new age stop motion films, it's more than that too, because they really want to get it like extra smooth. So just keep that in mind every time you watch a stop motion film, of the work that had to go into it to make it that beautiful and that stunning. And that seamless, it just makes it like such a pleasure to view again and again and again and again, and see the background characters moving and breathing and blinking, and they have to take into account all of these things as they go, which is just wild to me. They said that the hardest scene to do was the doorknob to Christmas Town. And the reasoning is because there is a perfect reflection in the doorknob behind Jack. So there's no place to hide the camera, the equipment, the people. So every shot has to be like posed, everything has to be moved away, then the shot has to be taken. Then he has to reach a little bit more, everything has to move. Is he in the same position? Okay, then the shot has to be taken. And you can't see the equipment. Like, yes, some of it can be edited out in post, but like, it's a perfect reflection on the knob of what he's doing. So you can't have anything behind him, but you need things behind him to hold him up. So that sort of made things a little bit difficult. But they said that was the hardest scene to do, but they did it, and it's amazing. Yeah. I don't know about you, but I personally hate having to go to the grocery store. It takes up so much of my day when I could be starting a new hobby with that time, like soap carving, or collecting the sick bags out of airplanes. With Instacart, it makes grocery shopping fast and easy, all while allowing me to stay in my underwear. Instacart allows you to order all of the things you usually get from your local stores, delivered to your door in as fast as 1 hour. Not only that, but it will also give you smart suggestions for new items based off of your preferences, as well as highlight deals to help you save some money. The shoppers handpick perfect produce and make sure that your eggs get to you safely. You can get free delivery on your first order over $35 by following the link in the show notes. This also lets Instacart know that we sent you, and it helps support Whispers from Below. So if you hate grocery shopping as much as I do, try Instacart today and enjoy getting your groceries the easy way. Number six is that Patrick Stewart actually did an introduction and closing for the film that are only really found on the soundtrack. And in this extended ending on the soundtrack, Santa Claus revisits Halloween Town and sees that Jack Skellington has actually had like around 4 to 5 like little skeleton kitties. There's like an intro in the soundtrack that you can listen to that's Patrick Stewart, and an outro. And initially they were going to have this in the film, but it made the runtime just a little bit too long. So they cut it, which is really unfortunate. Because I think that the way that it sort of bookends the film is really, really nice. And personally, when I listen to the soundtrack, because of course I do, I listen to the score and the soundtrack and stuff like that because I'm wild. I think it does a great job of bookending the soundtrack as well. So I always listen to the intro and the, I guess the outro, like the introduction and the closing. I always listen to them all the way through because I just think it's really nice. Number seven, Jack Skellington. I wrote Jack Skellington loves a good cameo. So Jack Skellington was such a popular character that he actually made cameos in a bunch of other films after that. And actually one film prior to his conception. So in Beetlejuice, that's the one I'm referring to, when there's that scene where Beetlejuice is like coming out of the ground and he is a carousel. Like, he is, like, a big carousel. And at the top of the carousel, there is a skeleton head, which is just from a doodling of Tim Burton. But it is Jack Skellington's head, and it is what he looks like. This movie came out before Nightmare Before Christmas was ever a thing. In conception, ever, like, just not a thing. So he makes a fun cameo there before he was even conceived, which I love. And then he also makes an appearance in Coraline, and I believe in Coraline, when she cracks the egg into the glass, he is the yolk. The yolk of the egg is just a Jack Skellington head, I believe is what it is, in one of the kitchen scenes with the mother. I believe that that's what it is, but I could be wrong. And then also he supposedly makes an appearance in Princess and the Frog, James and the Giant Peach, and Alice in Wonderland. So you can look up those little things and find them, but he loves a good cameo. Jack Skellington is like Mickey Mouse. He's just like all over the place for some reason. Number eight, the album, there was an album that came out after Nightmare Before Christmas because it became very popular with this sort of like pop rock community. So this album came out called Nightmare Revisited. It features songs from the film done as like pop rock or screamo, or done in a different orchestral way, or sort of in like an EDM way. EDM? Is that the right one? Yeah. Electronic dance music. So it features songs by like Evanescence, Korn, Marilyn Manson, Flyleaf, All American Rejects, Plain White Tees, Rise Against. You know, these bands that are like pop punk legends, or in some cases like screamo legends, just like living their truth out, loving Nightmare Before Christmas and doing like genuine covers. And it's an amazing album. I also listen to it, like, not a lot anymore, but like back in like my middle school to high school days, like, yeah, you best believe this was playing at all times, like all the time, like all the time. Flyleaf's cover of What's This is like absolutely fantastic. I think Marilyn Manson does This Is Halloween, which is dope. Korn, oh my god, Korn doing Kidnap the Santa Claus, and there's the part where a shock just goes, "Shut up, I've got something, listen now, this one is real good, you'll see." And on the soundtrack, it just kind of like pushes through it. And then in the Korn one, he goes, "Shut up, And the whole band, like, everything cuts out. And then it comes back in with him, like, I've got something. Listen now. This one is real good. You'll see. And it gets me every time. Like, it gets me so hype every single time. Like, sometimes that song will come on, like, shuffle on, like, a playlist or whatever. And I'll be like, I don't really want to listen to the whole song. But I have to listen to that one part. And I'll skip ahead and I'll hear, shut up. I've got something. Listen now. And I'm like, yeah, this is it. This is life. This is the life I'm living, and I couldn't be more happy about it. So check it out. Nightmare Revisited. You can, like, stream it everywhere. It's pretty dope. Number 9, there were over 400 Jack Skellington heads that were used for all of his extreme facial expressions. So they used replacements for every single one of his expressions and emotions, which is why the animation in his face is so smooth. They used, like, a replacement method. But that does mean that for every smile, like, every second of a smile, there had to be, like, 12 different heads to use. Do you know what I mean? Like, just think about that. That's wild and crazy and ridiculous. Absolutely wild. So there were over 400 heads that they used. And I believe they, like, auctioned them all off at some point and, like, sold a bunch of them. Disney did, I think. But crazy that, like, that's a thing that they had to do for the film. And there's so many of them. Like, that's why I think his little heads make a lot of cameos in other films, because they just, like, had a bunch of them. And they were like, I guess we're gonna use these for something. Throw it in there. It'll be a fun little thing for people to look at. And the very, very last fun fact that I have today, number 10, for those of you counting at home, is that Burton has stated very clearly that he does not plan on making a sequel for the film. Like, at all. Like, he has no plans. Like, for Beetlejuice, he was like, there was a plan, and, like, maybe I could still do it. I think it might still work. We'll think about it. And for this one, he's like, no, I will not be doing it. I will not be doing, you know, Nightmare Before Thanksgiving. I will not be doing Jack Goes to St. Patrick's Day Town. Like, I won't do it. And the reasoning is that he says that he, quote, doesn't do sequels or things like that, unquote. But also he stated in an interview multiple times that he thinks Nightmare Before Christmas is so pure that there's no point in creating a sequel, because it would simply ruin what's been created. And why ruin this thing that he's made? And to be fair to him, why would you ruin this thing that makes you, frankly, a lot of money? Like, Nightmare Before Christmas merch and all of that is huge. Like, walk into a Hot Topic or a Boxed Lunch and tell me that you don't see the Nightmare Before Christmas stuff. It's crazy. You can find it everywhere, which is great for people like me that, like, love it so much. But I'm sure that it makes him a lot of money. And, like, why would you touch that? If you know that it's going to make you money and you know that people still love it, it's pure. Like, don't touch it. Also, if it really is, like, one of your love children that, like, you created while you were at Disney and, like, you were an animator there and then whatever, like, also don't touch it then either. Like, keep it the way it is. So I totally understand. I don't, like, while I would love to see, like, how Jack would react to going to different holidays, I don't think it's the same. I don't think it would have the same effect as Christmas Town has. So anyway, that's my 2 cents on it. And those are my 10 facts. That's all I really got to say. I don't have much else to say about it, except that if you haven't seen this movie yet, you're a fucking criminal and you should go see it. Like, it's on Disney Plus. It's on a bunch of streaming platforms. It's everywhere to view. You don't have an excuse to not go see it. It's amazing. We're in the quarantine times still for most of us. So, like, go check it out. It's amazing. Also, get vaccinated if you can. It's awful, the second dose, but, like, worth it because you don't die. So I think that that's definitely a plus. Couple quick things. So if you guys like this episode or you have ideas for future episodes, you can always hit me up through the contact page on my website, whispersfrombelow.com. Or alternatively, you can send me a DM on Instagram, whispersfrombelow, no spaces, no underscores, no capitals, no nothing. It's pretty cool there. You can check it out. I usually am way better about posting on there, but I wasn't this past week. But that's normally where you can find updates if I didn't upload an episode or if I decide to upload two episodes in a week or anything like that. That's where you'll get the most information on it. So you should probably check out the Instagram and follow it. It's pretty cool. I post pretty cool stuff there. I post like every Monday about what the episode is. I always, always, always have my phone near me. So if I get a DM that's like, hey, you should try this episode, I pretty much will respond within the day because my phone is always near me. I might be at work, so it might take me some time, but like I definitely will respond. If you guys are interested in supporting the show at all, please follow the Instagram, subscribe to the website. But the biggest thing that you can do is check out patreon.com/whispersfrombelow. There is a bunch of different tiers with a bunch of different cool rewards for patrons. There's t-shirts, water bottles, a Discord chat where you can talk with me and a bunch of other people that are similar to you. There is also like monthly, or I guess it's like quarterly stickers that you can get that are like custom designed for you and stuff like that. It's really cool and you should go check it out. And it just helps support the show. So I would absolutely love it if people would go support it. I would love to get 25 patrons by the end of the year is my big goal. So if you guys could go over and check that out, that would be absolutely amazing. Other than that, keep in mind, this is one of the best movies of all time. Remember, it's one of my favorites. Number two, get vaccinated if you can. Stay safe. And number three, stay safe. I'll say it again. Stay safe. I can't say it enough times. Stay safe.